Well, welcome. I'm Terry Irwin. I'm the head of the School of Design here at CMU. And before I introduce our lecturer tonight, I just want to mention that today's lecture is part of both the School of Design's Design the Future lecture series and is also a CMU University lecture series. And these are also, the lecture is also presented in partnership with the Department of HCI and the Frank Gracchi Studio for Creative Inquiry. Now, lectures like this one that are sponsored by multiple departments are very special because they always speak to the wide influence and the deep impact a speaker's research or practice has had across a diverse and complementary set of disciplines. And I think this commitment to transdisciplinarity is one of the best things about Carnegie Mellon University. So I am very honored tonight to welcome and introduce Professor Hiroshi Ishii. He is the Jerome B. Wiesner Professor of Media Arts and Sciences at the MIT Media Lab, where he is head of the Tangible Media Group. Prior to joining the Media Lab in 1995, Professor Ishii led a CSCW research group at NTT Human Interface Laboratories, where he and his team invented the well-known Team Workstation and Clearboard. He was a visiting assistant professor at the University of Toronto from 1993 to 94. Professor Ishii received his BE degree in electronic engineering and ME and PhD degrees in computer engineering from Hokkaido University, Japan. And in 2006, ACM SIGCHI elected him to the Chi Academy in recognition for his important contributions to the field of human-computer interactions through the creation of a new genre called tangible user interfaces. Professor Ishii is often referred to as the father of tangible media, and his research focuses on designing interfaces between humans, digital information, and the physical environment. His group has recently introduced the concept of radical atoms, a vision of the future of interaction involving hypothetical dynamic materials in which physical information manifests digitally. Wow. This work emphasizes that the development of tangible interfaces requires the rigor of both scientific and artistic review. Now, I've been told that Professor Ishii wanted to give his lecture tonight in this particular auditorium because he was a good friend of the late Randy Pausch, who was a professor in the departments of computer science and HCI here at CMU. In 1998, Randy tried to convince Professor Ishii to move to CMU from MIT, and though he did not succeed in luring him here, they remained close friends and colleagues. And in 2007, Professor Ishii was in the audience when Randy Pausch delivered his now famous last lecture. At the end of the lecture, as Professor Ishii approached the stage, Randy Pausch hugged him and he literally says, lifted him up onto a stage, which was previously here, where he will deliver his talk tonight. So in a way, it comes full circle. Would you please all join me in welcoming Professor Hiroshi Ishii.
Thank you, Terry. It's really great and also very important moment for me to come back to this stage where Randy Pausch, my very good friend, gave amazing last lectures. And also before starting this talk, I really care about transdisciplinary, interdisciplinary. I really appreciate this event was hosted by Terry Irwin from Head of School of Design, but also in collaboration with HCI Institute led by Anin Day, and also my old friend, Goran Levin. He's the director of Studio of Creating Inquiries. I really like all design, HCI, but I like no concept of inquiry. Asking a really profound new question is so important rather than solving the well-defined, obvious problems. How to come up with a new question from a new perspective
is something very, very important. It's a foundation of my research. That's the reason my work tend to go to very abstract, beyond technology, application, but the vision. So Randy Pausch inspired so many people on this planet. How many people you were here in 2007, September 18th? Great, I was also fortunate to be here and seeing his amazing strong message. And also I'm so happy to coming back, to return to him. It's one of my dreams. So today, I'd like to talk the endeavor towards radical autonomous. This is kind of very crazy, kind of artistic idea we've been working in the past several years. But usually very high level abstract concepts is very difficult to be understood or appreciated in the scientific community or engineering community because no concrete substance you can measure quantitatively. But Alcetonica took this concept very seriously. They use entire festival as radical atoms and the alchemist of our time. So we make a new materials to represent our artistic idea, then communicate and inspire people. How many people been to Alcetonica? I know Grand Levin is a star king. Every year I enjoy his amazing presentation. But ours is another very different domain, sheds light from different perspectives of art, technology, and the society. So in Alcetonica, we had a great opportunity to showcase all the evolution from tangible bits to radical atoms. 15 years ago, I had an exhibition of tangible bits called Getting Touch in Alcetonica. But here, combining with the new endeavor of radical atoms, we could show all the history of evolution in showcase. So this is a really great opportunity for us because partially we could share all this experience with my students, including Lin Yao here. Also, you see the, all the history from a pixel to tangible bit radical atoms is on the wall. So this is a tangible media, but also I really appreciate how much I owe to amazing students and colleagues. Time really flies. It's kind of a surprise, but already 20th anniversary last year, medieval 30th anniversary. So many amazing alumni came to my lab and celebrate the accomplishment, but also I'm still surviving. So that's good, not to retire. So I think this really gives an amazing engine. So I think students are the future. How to inspire, how to give the baton of the interesting, important challenge is something most important mission for us. So let's go back to the history. 1992, I had opportunity to develop the collaboration media called Clearboard in NTT. At that time, I was very much interested about design, the seamless collaboration media. So seamless was the keyword, the vision. So many unnecessary seam between technical incompatibility or remote space. So this is like already more than 25 years old piece, but like big drafting table, see through your remote partner, but you can read the gaze very precisely. Gaze beam is not distracting. It's a combination of the Skype and the Google Doc, but you can really see where your partner is paying attention. I didn't want to make an isotropic extension of space without any distraction. This one is a seamless media design, which also like Randy liked a lot. So 1995, I was headhunted by, actually 1994, headhunted by Alan Kay and Nicolas Negroponte in Atlanta. Then I moved to MIT Media Labs in 1995. But one thing I've been consistently pursuing is approach to pursue the transdisciplinary design or research approach. So in summary, finding opportunity in conflict between disciplines, breaking down old paradigm to create new archetype. That is a strategy. Art and design, science, technology, business, all have a different value system. There's a collision, incompatibility. That old opportunity, you can do Aufheben, if you speak German. So in a moment of language, I really like the space, idea colliding. People never agree with one solid monolithic idea, but each people have different perspective, but they collide. Then that become an opportunity emerging design. Then new discipline transcending. especially like art and science, is very profound. I'm so moved that the name of Randy Pash was associated to the bridge. How many people cross that bridge? It's easy to physically cross that bridge, but actually through research to bind is something tough. So I'd like to show one of the examples that my recent Dr. Xiao Xiao, who did bridging between music and technology. One of the challenges, how people appreciate the music. Music is not vibrating air hitting your ear. Even before sound starts, pianist vibration, motion, everything is already part of music. How to convey all the subtle emotional expression, embodied interaction, is one of the key. So this is a challenge against MP3 player or streaming audio. But now you see ghostly presence of pianist living in the piano forever can hit the key physically. So you can really play your concert pianist grandma who passed away. So this is one of the approach to really how to bring embodied interaction to the artistic expression. Also, we love design a lot. So this is a piece we did for Milano Design Week. How many people went to Milano Design Week? A lot of the great furniture design and the industry design. So this is a piece called the Transform. We presented in 2014. Some kind of the conflict and outhaven between two juxtaposed concepts. One which is dance, technology and design.
As you can make another one pixel dance on the computer screen today.
And also nature.
But this is a real physical, real world in your body space. It's also actuator machine to move inert shy materials, let the ball dance. This is a new medium of interactivity or expression, communication. We believe inventing new materials, then providing this for the most creative people like you guys, then explores new expression, new possibility, something most exciting. So this is a summary of my battles against the Pixel Empire. I've been fighting this Pixel Empire for 22 years since I joined MIT Medials. The battle is against Pixel. Pixel is such a profound, malleable representation of idea, information in computer screen, but fundamentally intangible. You can't grab, hold, taste, smell, or manipulate using a body. You always have to use a remote control like a mouse, completely decoupled. That sucks. That's the reason we decide to, I'm sure it's proper English, but anyway, try to make a physical embodiment of the information so that the tip of the iceberg exposed to the physical world, so you can use your body to grab and manipulate all the dexterity. However, physical materials, like these materials, very frozen, very rigid. They can dance. That also sucks. So I decided to also hack material, so the material can transform, also changing a property, like a viscosity, or flexibility, or elasticity, or stiffness. So it may sound very crazy, but always driving engine of my research is a vision. And of course, if you're the engineer, you care technology, develop amazing technology, then look for the meaningful application. Also, designer may look for the what problems of the user, then solve, providing new service and application. Those are really great, pragmatic, important approach. But also, I believe there's another approach, starting from the more high-level visions, like a Barnabas Bush, the Memex vision, that is the base of the hypertext. Also, my hero, Douglas Engelbart, came up with collective intelligence many, many years ago. Those high-level ideas, something matter because it lasts much longer. All the technology now you are using in your pocket goes to landfill in 3 years, whatever is usable. That's the part. Obsolescence is embedded in the design. Also, application change the shape and replaced by other stuff. But the fundamental principle or vision may last much longer. So that's my dream. So digital and physical boundary, many people working on this boundary, but our take was let physical embodiment
of digital information and the computation so that you can grab and manipulate using the hands. Let me show one of the very classic pieces called the music bottles. Bottles, perfume bottles, you open it, then contents, this time music, distance, coming out. So the reason I designed this bottle is very personal, because I have a dream to give a present to my mom and to present bottles which contain the weather forecast of Sapporo City, my hometown. So when she wakes up in the bedside, the blue bottles is waiting for her, and if she opens, you will hear the words of today. The reason is she cooked for me, opening soy sauce bottles 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times, so she knows all the meaning of the bottles. And I never want her to use computers or smartphone. But she passed away in 1998, so to fill the big hole, we designed this piece. Also, next year, my dear friend, Mark Weiser, passed away. And he was also very strong visionary. He talked about technology become invisible, woven into the fabric of everyday life. That's a very profound message. So that I wrote a paper as a tribute to Mark Weiser as one of the example to represent his ideas. So I think many of the stuff doesn't come from practical ideas, but the more artistic, emotional engine that drove many of my design. So now I'd like to talk about a bit different topics. How many people paint water or oil? Great. How many people have a sketchbook now? Oh, good. That's good. Designer, artist, Mickey. I think drawing, sketching, something super important. Let me introduce IO brush. But work done, Kimiko Ryokai, Stefan Maritz. How many people saw this video before? Oh, not so much. Yeah. Oh, good, good. One of the inspiration came from a Renaissance era. Painters was also pigment maker. They made their own pigment or ink, not to use given ink by teacher or parents. If they want to have a purple, they want to seashore, collecting seashells, they make their own purple. In Asia, they collected the plants. So creating own materials to paint with really connect people to the real physical world. So this color is very different from RGB dry data because you have emotional attachment, color of loved one, memory, and all the story is associated. Because using your technology, we can do a lot of things. But the most important thing is not the functionality. If you go to Whole Foods Market, you see beautiful fruits or color leaves. But that inspires you. What kind of a new art piece you may want to create with IO brush? These are not something just to eat or consume, but ink waiting for you to make a new art piece. How to create chain reaction towards creation is one of the goals of interaction design that our team does. So, paintings is kind of a dead ink stuck on the canvas or surface. But now you see teddy bear over there. So the history from where this color came from. This is a new dimension. That's a departure from the painting. It looks like a painting, but go beyond that.
But also kids
went far beyond my our imagination. That's a very important moment. She didn't listen to what MIT professor told her in the history or record. She just came up with her own interpretation, and so she's so proud of it. I think that's so that's an interaction design to stimulate creative mind. And also, this is beyond the functionality, because Kimiko puts the title, the world, as a palette. That is something interactive experience of the eye brush make people see the world very differently, like wearing new eyeglass through which you see all the possibility. Beautiful color leaves on campus of CMU is invite you to make a new art piece, impression of the fall, for example. So seeing the world from a different point of view, creative point of view, is something we care a lot. So this different project called Ping Pong Plus. How many people play ping pong? Seriously? Okay. Do you have a ping pong table on campus? Oh, okay. Maybe later. We have been into ping pong is kind of zero-sum game to make the opponent make a mistake to get the point. That's kind of very, kind of not so collaborative. But even you make a mistake, ball hit the network, I want to create all the interesting like effect for the audience. So using 8 microphone, then just comparing the time. It's pretty old technology, like almost 20 years ago, but it became a quite interesting platform or social media to engage all the audience. Also the kids, designer, can make your own like audio-visual effect so that you can really put a new layer in the social-physical interaction. Also, my students, a former student, James Patton, well, he was a student of Randy Pausch, also Ben Licht, was a real designer, but also a computer scientist. They like the computer music. So they designed this audio pad. And this was presented in Arte Tonica, also Nike. Then Sergio in the Barcelona got inspired. They make a React table. Then many famous musicians start using on the stage. So I'm very happy to see the chain reaction of the influence. But the blue object in the center represents microphone, virtual microphone. Distance of the microphone and the source of the music determines the volume, but also a lot of complex parameters. Then you can use two hands or four hands to manipulate. But the more important thing is movement of the hands really communicate to the listener why change of the sound happens. Problem of the computer music is from a distance, you see musician bring notebook computer, but you can tell what they're doing. Actually, they're doing or just hitting play button. But acoustic instrument, it's clear causality chain. How to make causality chain legible and engaging between musician and audience was one of the intention. These are all the tabletop tangible interface in the early stage. So I'd like to explain why tangible matters. For me, representation of ideas matter. If you represent the idea mathematical formula, you can apply set of the rigorous theoretical linear operators. But that's all. If it's a special painting, you can specially reconfigure. That's amazing operator. But you can apply any mathematical operator. Selection of representation constraint, mental operator. That's constraint in design space. So how to create new representation which multiply inherit from physical world, digital world, is one of my dream. So this orality is very powerful because of the interface. This part connects to your body. Then your body becomes part of the engine. When you rotate the planet, there's no ambiguity why four seasons exist, why all the phenomena happens.
because your body, kinesthesia, muscle, nervous system is part of the system. But the current digital completely decoupled, sitting, clicking, but your body is not engaged.
Also perfect 3D. Current 3D is fake 3D from one person point of view in 2D screen. It's not real. But in the real 3D, you can use all the kinesthesia, body, changing posture. The causality chain of the change of the view and the kinesthesia is very clear. That clarity is missing. That's the reason we studied the tandem bits in 1995. Then also we submitted the paper to CHI conference. This is a vision paper, so it's almost rejected because no scientific evaluations. But Mark Weiser and Jim Horan were two reviewers. They strongly championed. And Mark wrote me the email, this is a paper of the vision of the 21st century with the computing. That's my treasure. I put in the Facebook. But those encouragement, amazing encounters of these pioneer helped me survive. It's paper rejected. Maybe I didn't exist here. But this is one of the most cited paper because it's not an international technique paper or user study paper or system paper, but a vision paper to point the future direction or high level thinking. Let me show one of the most compelling example that done by John Andacofra, my first PhD student.
Professional use, this time in the field of architecture and urban planning. IRF employs wireframe architectural models as the focus of a number of integrated simulations, including the generation of accurate shadows. These projective shadows are carefully aligned with and permanently affixed to the base of each architectural structure.
So you see the shadow. These are computer shadows. Also, you can move the clock. Then you can change vertical position of the sun, so you can control the shadows. So you can explore the inter-shadow problems. Also, if you change the material of the surface building to grassy building, like Los Angeles, you can also simulate the reflection light, which may hit the eyes of the drivers on the highway. And, of course, we love fluid dynamics. How many people with the Mekki love fluid dynamics?
Navier-Stokes equation. That's beautiful. If you're an artist, designer, you should try Navier-Stokes equation. And anyway, so
this every time you change the position of the buildings, boundary condition change. That is fed into the underlying Navier-Stokes equation, recompute. But you can really use your hands, two hands or four hands, then you can move like a building block. So that's a way to communicate and evaluate the new urban stuff. How many people from an architecture background? Great. I think architecture really inspired a lot for our research because of the relevance to the interaction design. Also, we learn so much from landscape design, and the landscape designer has been using a clay and also the sometimes sand. So we made a sandbox called Sandscape in 2003, and it was commissioned by Ars Electronica. So we made simple versions. User use a laser range finder. It's very expensive. So it's a half translucent optical beads shining the infrared light. So this vector shows the water running direction. Like water drain is a big issue. When you have a heavy rain, how water run down? How erosion happens? How landscape may change? So these are kind of the interaction. You can give the form giving, manipulating sand for the beauty, aesthetics. But simultaneously, you can also optimize, do all the computational analysis about use of the land, water drainage, or shadow, how much sunlight each slope gets, so that which flower or tree can survive. So these are simple examples. But the problem is, those sands are shy, frozen. They don't remember the shape. You know, shape memory alloy, shape memory materials. But sand forget. I want sand to remember the shape before they change, then restore or replay like a mountain building. That's the reason we went to the next level called radical atoms. I want materials remember, dance, and the change the shape and the property dynamically.
So currently, artist, designer, engineer have two choice of materials. One is frozen atoms like wood, metal, or glass, or plastic. Other stuff is dynamic, but completely intangible pixel, which is incompatible with the body. So we want to make a new materials, which is called radical atoms, which is dynamic, physical, and computational materials that transform, driven by the bits, which sounds very abstract, but I show a bunch of examples.
So this is an early prototype Daniel Reitzinger did for his master's thesis called Relief. And this is one of the instance of the application, which also Austin Lee, you contributed, helping to communicate. But the rendering used to be the pixel. But now rendering is both pixel, also physical manifestation through shape display. But they are both connected, synchronized. If you change digital, shape changes. Also, if you change the physical material, this is like a traveling through the time. Like if a mountain erosion or a mountain building, you can go back to history. Then you can directly manipulate, but also you can use mid-air gesture. So we are inventing a new representation and a new interaction, how to communicate to these new materials to convey your idea. So this is a very early prototype and the low resolution. And then Sean Former, Danny Reitzinger, and all people made a crazy 900 pin working system called Inform. So this is became very famous for this telepresence application. How many people saw this video? Oh, good. That's very popular. It's part of the YouTube. Because you saw the career about I did 25 years ago, revisiting the physical telepresence, or Shaoxia's mirror field is something very important for me. But now you can see it's not just being present, you can manipulate, telemanipulate, telekinesis. This is totally different from video conferencing or master slave robot or surrogate. Also because you can use any found object, it's not necessarily the body. Any object you capture can be digitized, then be physically embodied. And if you like, you can also read the books. Also, of course, you can do the design. But the important thing is intermaterial interaction. It can move inert objects. That's something very important spike, so that you can also grab the attention of. But this is an important book of Bill Moglish, late Bill Moglish, another hero, the book about design. And also notion of the affordance, physical affordance, that Gibson or Don Norman argued is based on the relatively persistent physical nature. But once materials start dancing dynamically, you have to really change the concept. You have to redevelop the theory. So this is a product design. You can also extrude, give a form. But also another important thing, printing. Printing is a dead end. If you print, usually it can get frozen. So these are financial data. It's not a printing, it's still alive. Please, so now you see, it's constantly recomputing because constraint is satisfied by the recomputing. So this recomputation ability or memory really gives a new dimension of expression, communication, simulation. It's really crazy to engineer those 1,000 pins. And MIT students are so like, yeah. Also, this is another artistic stuff. So I think this was really great that we have a lot of the exposures and awards, but also we had a chance to exhibit this piece in the Cooper Hewitt Design Museum. Did anybody have a chance to see in New York? Good. So now this machine is in Linz, Austria, Ars Electronica, for 1 year at least. You have a chance to go to Linz. Please express the physical telepresence. Always we really enjoy artistic expression. This is an informal videos, but we love Escher. Escher really inspired a lot. So impossible structure or infinite perpetual motion. This is ourselves struggling in a corporate maze, for example. So don't ask me why. This is art. This is not a pragmatic utility. But we really enjoy those exploration of expression. So using a three engine of inform, we started design transform to make a kinetic triptych. So this is a transform. And let me show the video that each designer or engineer talk about the idea behind it. So many people work together to build, make interactions.
of the scenarios.
Our response to the amazing emotion.
Let's jump to, my students. This is boring. So okay, go ahead. Okay, Sean Forman. He's now professor of Stanford. Did a significant contribution with dynamically.
So usually a furniture is a static
animation object. Story design.
We wanted to give it some kind of motion, to give it some life form, so to explore the interplay of static and dynamic, which we can achieve with these pins that react to you, but also can display any content.
We don't want that the furniture will become to be more important than the motion itself, but we still want to make it feel like it's a one unified design, and they're not separated.
Amit Zoran is an amazing designer. He's a now professor of Hebrew University in Israel.
We have over 1,000 motors that we need to control precisely with a computer. So for us, the biggest challenge was, instead of trying to hide the complex machine, we make it disappear through the beauty of motion.
So this is a transform, and we exhibit in Milano Design Week, and a lot of people came, but let me show the story we told. So the theme was nature versus machine. We started emulating the pond or lake where fish, school of fish, swimming on the pond. The people can energize the waters, agitate, make a wave. This is a simulation of the nature. The machine became jealous because of the beauty of the nature. Machine tried to imitate the aesthetics of the wave. The machine started developing parametric design formula under the water. Keep refining, let the algorithm evolve under the water. Then in the end, machine came to the quite unique form of emulated version of the wave. Machine was also lonely because they don't have friends to dance, dine together, or tweet, or Facebook. But they found the friend. It's a frozen atoms. Shy, frozen, red balls. It doesn't have any digital consciousness, but they can dance together. Like a history of ancient civilization. So there was a king, empire, castle near the seashore, BC 5000. They built amazing city, but it didn't last long. Nature came back. Then all the castle became a sand castle, started sinking under the water. So, I think a transform is something equivalent of invention, creation of a new white canvas, paintbrush, and ink, waiting for Picasso, Gogh, Matisse. Would you like to be? That was the question we asked in Milan. So there's a lot of interesting collision we use, because Lexus, our collaborator, has a very powerful concept, intriguing elegance through careful juxtaposition of opposing elements. That's a collision. So design, Milano Salone, design, furniture, static, skin deep, surface beauty, but the beauty of dynamic motion, driven by technology, is very different ideas.
also stillness and motion, atoms and bits. We carefully try to use the energy of the collision of those concepts. So we're very happy to work with the amazing people and getting a lot of the good recognition. But also we realize those stuff have quite interesting possibility to become new metamaterials. You can now emulate a lot of different property of the materials, soft, squishy. So we are now starting a project, mathematically develop precise models of variety of the materials so that you don't have real samples, but you can really materialize, emulate flexibility or elasticity or viscosity. Yeah, I don't show the mathematical equation, but it's on a Kai paper. But now you can really emulate those stuff. Then also you can really feel these materials using entire body or cheek. That is something very different from pixels and the mouse. So shape display started from a lot of the interesting shape change, direct manipulation. Then we show the physical telepresence, inter-material interaction, dynamic affordance. Now we are getting to the material property emulation using a very precise force feedback technology. So these are underlying approach. But this is a small part of the much bigger movement. These are all the, like a trajectory from static passive stuff to the more dynamic active stuff, namely tangibles to radical atoms. It's a more zoomed picture, but the upper side you see shape changing displays, like an inform transform. But also we have another series of the stream called the Promos Materials, which is led by Linial, Gifeo, a bunch of my colleagues. So I'd like to show some of the examples. So our team develops a new pneumatic user interface using air as a way to make a shape changing, but carefully computing about desirable transformation, then making compound materials of elastic and non-elastic. So pumping air, you can make a desirable controlled flat programs as shape changing. So you can now really emulate and materialize a lot of interesting shape change by fabricating the new materials. Also sensor and shape changing all together. So the always system knows what shape now it's taking. So you can give the feedback. Also all the texture provide very fine tuned granular like feedback to the hands of the maybe driver grabbing a steering wheel. So these are very interesting new directions. Also our team led by Gifeo and Rini did a jam sheet. This is not a shape, but a stiffness, tunable stiffness. So this is like a yoga mat, but sucking the air, pumping air, it become hard and also soft. So you can really bring the mat, then change the shape, then make it hard. That really changed the notion of the furniture. Table chair, always table chair, but you have a long sheet of the carpet, you can really give a new form. Also like runner's shoes or skier's boots is something very important because always kind of frozen, but the shape and the stiffness should change based on the ski slope or running distance or fatigue. So a lot of interesting science. This was done in collaboration with New Balance. Also, this year in Kai Conference, Gifeo and his team presented the cilia. This is a very fine 3D printed hair. But this provides not only the fine hair, but a lot of the interesting capability. Now you can make all the variety of the brush and adhesive materials. That's obvious in some sense. But also by vibrating, you can make inert object on top of the hair move as you wish. That's a very important spike. So you can make a ballerina dance or music turntable. Any vibration makes things move. So that's a very new engine to make actuations. Also, based on the direction you touch the hair, by using a Fourier analysis, you can really detect the direction of touch, how you touch to the hair by sound analysis. So soft new materials has a lot of interesting possibility to enhance the human materials interaction. Nicolas Negroponte said in last year that the bio is a new digital. reflecting all the breakthrough in the CRISPR or gene synthetic biology. And our team came up bio is a new interface led by Lining, Wenwang, Chunying, Jifei, and a bunch of the scientists, designer, engineer. We start studying about the nature, biological materials, and we focus on the hygromorphic shape-changing capability embedded in the natural materials. Then we studied all the variation on the vocabulary, but we pick up natto cell, Bacillus subtilis natto. Then our team design the biologic. So now you see zoomed in microscopic view of the cell. That become a sensor of relative humidity, also actuator driven by the relative humidities. Then carefully computing, analyzing the performance, then carefully print onto the fabric and making the garment. You can make a breathing second skin. And this is a video clip from the exhibition. How to communicate this scientific accomplishment, translate into the language of design and also art. So you now see the textile changing the shape based on the steam. This is a bioprinter that our team designed to for the deposition of the liquid containing the bacteria, and also cultivating the billions of bacteria in the lab. This is a display using a mannequin to show how their skin changes the shape. But the best is the real people, real artists wear and dance, being conscious about natto bacteria on their back. So this was an event that our team organized for the 30th anniversary of MIT Media Labs. So this is a very interesting exercise for us to the deep scientific research, but also transfer into the technology, fabric, fashion design, and also the artistic expression. So far, dance is one of the important things, making material dance, or bacteria dance, or dancer dance with bacteria. But also we have a crazy dream to levitate anti-gravity. Anti-gravity is one of the dreams of Randy Pausch when he was a kid. So we took very literally. So we did a Zeron, Gina Lee, and Remy Post did this anti-gravity material called Zeron. It's not yet on the periodic table, but the Zeron you can put in the air, then stay there. Number two, computer knows exact location. Number three, computer can move it. So that become materials to mediate interaction between people in a 3D physical space and the computational world. We love astronomy. You can really understand Kepler's law, for example, if you like to simulate using these levitating materials. But important message is gravity sucks because you're on the ground because gravity, but you never question why you have to obey, what you have to constrain. So my main message, don't take it for granted, any constraints. Then question, why, how we can hack it? So one of the theme in Ars Technica, I curated the radical atom exhibition, but also I have a privilege to invite my best friends, Joachim Zalta from Artcom. How many people met Joachim Zalta? He rocks. He's an amazing designer and artist, and his Artcom did an infinite cube, 25 silver balls dancing, very beautiful, poetic, creative curation. Also, Ars Technica Center, Future Lab, did 100 drones flying in the air in sync of the music. So sky is a limit. So levitate. And also defy gravity. Those are important messages because now you have opportunity. Look above your head. You can design anything, the space above us. So that's a message I wanted to convey through this exhibition. I was very fortunate. Alan Kay invited me in 1994 to give a talk in Atlanta about CSCW, career board. But right after my talk, he came with Nicolas Negroponte, both advisor, and they asked me to come to MIT. And I thought, a PhD? And he said, you have to teach. So I have a 10 minutes break. So I thought a lot for 10 minutes, and I said yes. So that's the best decision, but also stupid decision, because I had no idea what MIT is. And also, as a condition of the hiring means, don't continue any work I've done before, like a careerable teamwork session series. You have to reboot. You have to start something from scratch, something most exciting. So that's the most horrible advice for non-tenured, untenured professor. But this challenge worked very well. Otherwise, I didn't start tangibles. I didn't go to radical atoms. So they pushed me beyond edge, which I really appreciate. Future is not predict, but invent. If your work really inspire people, they really follow you. Even if it's fringe, not mainstream, it's okay. Sometimes people may choose your approach over other approach. So I think vision is always important. To do so, you have to envision what kind of future you really want to make it happen. To do so, you have to embody, you have to implement. Otherwise, you can't communicate. Just abstract word doesn't communicate. So I need lot of the applications, topable, IO brush, music bottles, app, soundscape, to convince people there's something called tangibles which worth thinking. Also radical atoms, I have to implement, inform, transform, biologic. Then finally, people start to understand, oh, now I'm starting understanding there's something which makes sense. And also, work has to inspire, it has to stick. Otherwise, people don't remember, people don't think, because people are busy. So important things, engineering, technology, science, so important to embody. You have to know how to build it. But the more important things, what is worth building? What kind of future you want to design? Those questions, envision, come from the art and the philosophy. Art really matters. Also, in the end, you do so many 3D printing, but most of them go to landfill. Or even your cell phone, in 3 years, go to landfill. So you have to really inspire, stick certain fundamental vision. Then you have to go to level of the art, some aesthetics, some philosophical thinking. That's the reason I really like the studio of creative inquiries, inquire. And art is a very important driving force. I think, hope you really take this stuff seriously. So vision is all about perspective, how to see the world, how to really see the world differently, get determined. And people observed the universe space with naked eyes many years ago, but they invented telescope in the 14th century that enhanced the way people see the world. Then they made an amazing observatory, but all stuck on the earth, eyes are stuck in the head. Telescope, observatory are stuck on the earth. That's a limitation. But the remarkable things happen with Hubble Space Telescope, which decoupling the eyes from your head or earth, then fly to the deep space, then bring back amazing like a view, perspective. And also my favorite spaceship is Voyager. Do you know where the Voyager? It went beyond solar system. It's so beautiful. And also they use amazing technique called the gravitational slingshot. That's a very important metaphor to meet amazing people, get inspired. So that's a meaning of the meeting, discussing, collaborating with people. But because the gravitational slingshot, this spaceship went far beyond the solar system, keep changing the trajectory, accelerating. This is something very profound metaphor. Then it brings back the view of ourselves, us. We can't see ourselves with our eyes. So problem is very simple. People could only see the world from their own perspective. So we have to really enhance and also expand. Also we have to escape the constraints. And also world is changing so rapidly. You have to have a holistic perspective, how world is changing. Big cultural shift from owning to sharing is dramatic, destroying so many existing industries. You have to really understand holistic perspective. But life is short. You have only 24 hours a day. Maybe only 2 years for master, 4 years for PhD. I don't know. So you have to focus. Heuristic focus is very important. In our case, we focus on natto-bacteria. So holistic prospect and focus. But also to expand your prospect, meeting amazing people is so important. I was so fortunate could meet and discuss with all the amazing guru, Douglas Engelbart, Mark Weiser, Bill Mitchell. They made an amazing impact on my life. Also these guys, these gangs are helping a lot. Nicholas challenged me, Alan Kay also inspired Billy's most amazing friend. Do you know how to keep the friendship? Friend is not somebody say, you're beautiful, smart, please marry me. Friend is somebody you have to make, okay, usually we're busy. We meet every 3 years or 4 years. But when I meet next time, I will make you tell me that, oh my gosh, what a great idea. Why I couldn't come with this idea before you came up? This tension is a friendship. Seriously, John Maida, me, it's this tension. You can really keep friendship. You want to meet again. You work very hard. So that is the friendship. From this point of view, I really appreciate Randy Pausch. He gave a lot of the great insight. I couldn't come to CMU, but I want to introduce Goran Levin. I'm so proud of. He was my colleague, amazing colleague, but he bring a new perspective, creating a new stream. He's already rock star in Alpha Tonica, but starting revitalizing the studio of creative inquiry, providing amazing space, accepting so many orphans. Also, Media Lab was designed as a refugee camp. People who don't fit any existing discipline can come and create something. I really proud Goran is doing amazing stuff. And also I'd like to invite Austin Lee and Rini Yao. That is a return from my group to CMU. Because I couldn't fulfill the requirements of the Randy Pausch to quit MIT, come to CMU. But Austin Lee, he joined CMU 2015 as a faculty of School of Design. And yes, and Rini Yao just defended the PhD last week.
Last week.
He's now joining HCII, School of Computer Science, in CMU next year. So if you're interested about, yeah. I really want to thank to you and the Randy Pausch. Also, I really hope that you guys blossom and inspire. Thank you. So I'd like to thank to Terry, also Austin Lee, who made this visit happen. And today's a very special day because I came back to the press that I met Randy Pausch in 2007. I have a plan. I go to a different place very soon. But all together, no exception, soon. But it continues, world continues to exist. Think about 20 to 100. There's a bunch of people living on this planet. So the question I ask, also Randy asked is, what do you want to pass on to those living in 2000? Also, how do you want to be remembered? What do you want your legacy to be? That's a message, lesson I learned from Randy Pausch. So in short, 2200. So reason is, life has set end point. But the future is never ending. For that future, we are responsible. Even we disappear, even we retire, disappear, three future continue to exist. So we love technology, but we have to keep in mind, technology get obsolete very soon. But true vision lasts everlasting. So 2200, that's a lesson I learned from Randy. So thank you very much for your very kind attention. Thank you. Oh yeah, any question? If you are shy, I have a Twitter account. You can also tweet mention. It's very important to collecting all the feedback. But it's nice, there's a person over there. Is a microphone or? Oh yeah. Oh, that's a good question. Even 2007, last lecture, when Randy lifted me up, he said, if you're tired of MIT, come to CMU. It's a great place. Let me think. OK, is it a microphone? Or if not, would you mind come to?
Okay. I'll just yell. I'm curious, what do you think the place of reality
is? OK. Yeah, I think he asked a very important question about what relevance or difference of the mixed reality. And the VR and the mixed reality, augmented reality, is a huge hype. But in most cases, it's a visual augmentation of real world. You can layer the virtual annotation, but virtual is still intangible. So tangible radical atomism, opposite, extreme opposite approach using real physical materials. No overlaid illusion on top of the reality. However, perfect augmented reality and the perfect radical atoms become indistinguishable from each other. That's very profound. Any other question? Please don't be shy. Oh, really? Okay. Is any microphone that we can?
Can you speak up very loudly? When you have your visions of what you want to create, and you have many different visions, how do you focus on the ones you really want to do right
now? So when you have so many different visions, how to choose, how to focus one vision which you care? That's a very good question. We have so many ideas, but always ask what is most exciting stuff when I was kids. So for me, abacus. How many people compute with abacus? Great. Imagine I have abacus in my hands. Abacus is a physical embodiment of digits, which you can directly manipulate, but also provide a lot of joy. Become musical instruments, toy train, and back scratcher. Without reading any document. That's the beauty of the simple physical mechanical structure toy, which is lost in the black box called a computer or silicon tip. Why can't you bring back this transparency or joy back to human computer interaction? So abacus helped me to focus. But also, as a bystream of tangible bits, I did the ambient media. How do people can be aware what's going using peripheral awareness? Sound, subtle movement, air. That came from also abacus. When my mom was doing housekeeping, accounting, I know the music of the abacus telling me, she's busy, don't interrupt her, she can't play with me, wait. So this is important ambient media, because I was living in a small apartment in Tokyo, but always this sound signaled me, wait. So this single abacus really helps me to understand what is something I care, and what is missed in the current digital computation. So find your abacus, or find your orari in the historic scientific instruments, then become very clear. But it's very abstract. Until you build very compelling application like app, soundscape, carry boat, music bottles, nobody understands. So you really have a difficult time to communicate abstract, but don't give up. Keep developing. At least you need three legs, like a chair. Then people start listening. But keep developing more like legs. Then people understand. So now tangible became a very powerful word. Tangible TI, tangible embedded embodied computation conference is celebrating 10th anniversary, because all the people believe tangibility, embodiment is something very important. So even though abstract, it's very inclusive, artist, designer come. So I think you should really believe it. But having symbol, abacus, always in the back is always a good idea. Any other questions? Yeah.
What are your thoughts on virtual reality, and do you think that can go in this and media?
It's interesting. Virtual reality is completely opposite from Radic Atom's vision, because we believe real physicality, complete IO coincidence, and so that I want to make material itself change shape or augment rather than superimposed graphics or just completely immersed by the virtual imagery. So it's completely different philosophy, ontology. But I respect all the people who are really putting so much energy. So VR is hot. That's good. We can go far ahead of them. Because we know the limitation. VR is great, but fundamentally you can't replace your eyes and the human body. It's good for training, for the paid job, for 1 hour per day, but you never want to wear 24 hours. It's different. So fundamentally we know it. But I want to be nice, so I said, do VR. But I continue to do Radic Atom. Because our stuff is different, ahead of us. It's still very crazy, but people start believing, because one day I got a phone call from a medical doctor of Brigham Women Hospital. He's a pioneer of CT scan, digital. He asked me, can I use inform? And I said, of course, but the resolution so low. No, resolution not the point. Trained doctor, no. The stiffness difference of healthy organ and the tumor. They want to use this experience over distance. That's really enlightening me. Still technology immature, but that's something VR can never do that. But as I said, ultimate AR or VR and the Radic Atom might be indistinguishable. That's another very interesting philosophical question. But I stay away from VR from a strategic point of view. Yeah. Yeah. Of course, I think shape changing might be driven by the data, like financial data, so that you can really see that this display. But also there might be engine, filtering, extracting important pattern, then get attention of the operator. So definitely AI become very ubiquitous, as you know, it's so powerful. So world is full of so many complex data, but finding pattern, recurrent pattern, tendency and the communicating is so powerful, in spite of the type of the interface, GUI or tangible. AI become fundamentally ubiquitous, very powerful stuff. And we just lost late Marvin Minsky, but we are so proud that Marvin believe AI, and he's one of the pioneers. But that would be very exciting to see that what kind of the information is worth to make tangible and the visible. Yeah. Yeah.
So a lot of your work is about making and producing objects from the form interaction.
Yes.
But we as a society are very consumptive. And the reason why the black screen is so dominant is because it allows us to consume very, very easily. So yes. Do you think your work is sort of trying to put that away?
It's very difficult. You're talking about attention sucked into the screen, like a Facebook. How many people use a Pokemon Go? How many people more than level 10? How many people more than level 20? You should play. The reason is scarcity, most scarce resource is attention. How to use limited time for what application or what task is so important. Many companies, internet company or app company, are so scared because Pokemon Go getting so much attention from Facebook, other stuff. But it doesn't say Pokemon Go is good, although I like it. And So I think what is appropriate media? What is the appropriate way people should spend time? Is something so important because being together, but the people's attention is completely different space through the tiny screen that Sherry Turkle wrote in her book. That's very sad. Still, we really want to, today, it's so delightful. Professor Dambowetsky kindly showed me all the studio, walking around, so many sunlights, blue sky, then nice studio, high ceiling, walking, breathing the molecule of the creativity in the air, something so important. I can't do it in the screen. Also seeing the ceiling, why don't you hang something? I want to do some of the kinetic sculpture. Also, I'm very impressed about all the text on the stairs of your school of architecture, sorry, school of design. And in the building, there are all the words from the citation from the women who studied in the school. It's so profound. But if that's dynamically changing, the new poems that you like, or words that the Randy Pash left in the anniversary, then walking on the stair becomes such a joy. Also, people stop using elevator, become more healthy. All these ideas came from walking with good friend, Professor Dambowetsky, thinking about what we can do it. Then I see all the students there, so I talk to those ideas. Those never happen, just staring on the screen. So physical world, direct interaction is so important. So you have to really good strike balance. I think having multiple perspectives is so important. And I don't want to think about the future of the United States of America, but let's put aside. I think being Japanese or Asian was huge disadvantage because I'm not a native speaker. Also, I can't cut in during the discussion. Always I raise hand. But most people just keep talking. Not about dominate. So I have to learn how to really do turn taking. However, this weakness also becomes strength, aesthetics, different balance. Because this is a global world, international. So having a different perspective, but also being able to translate, interpret is so important. Because all the work we do, we publish as a scientific paper in the CHI, file the patent as technology, but also go to the get a design award, go to art exhibition. Because it's not just for the conceptual art, not just beauty design, not just pragmatic like engineering. Because we always pursue something profound. But you have to translate between four dimensions, art, design, science, technology, each have a different value system. You have to really translate. That's sometimes painful, but very important intellectual exercise. Even I have to translate into business, to fundraising. Yeah. But you have to enjoy those translation as important intellectual exercise. But to do so, the idea has to be deeper than any single dimension. So important message, people ask, are you a designer or artist? And I say, no, I'm not, none of them. So putting a label like artist means you don't need to care about how much money, time, cost to material this one. If you put a name, technician, engineer, you're not responsible to contribute artistic concept. That's very bad. Putting label really narrows the scope subconsciously, like choosing mathematical equation versus 2D drawing to exercising idea. So don't put the labels. CM is amazing. It's a university. It's not a collection of the college. All the amazing art design, science technology, usually you get stuck in a silo or 2D structure. Also amazing class. And also, if you can't find a good class, go to Grant Levin's studio. also Austin Lee, also Linear start a new group, and the design, art, everything exciting is kind of welcome. So you should really take advantage of being amazing campus of CMU. You can take any class, all the faculty is amazing, top class. But each faculty, each school has different value system. So think about how to translate your idea, which fit to the get a PhD from computer science, but also doing amazing artistic work, inspire people, and getting, amazing exhibition. So I think being CMU is an amazing privilege. So hope you enjoy it with amazing faculty and amazing students. Of course, it's not translatable. That's the reason I'm here.
Yeah. Yeah, so I was wondering so if you could share some insights on how did you like, come along, like convincing others to help you do the video, or like, convince people that your vision is next step.
I think there are certain things you can teach how to drive the bike. Also, there are certain things you can teach. For example, beauty, aesthetics. It's something you have to really develop, all the sensitivity, seeing the amazing art piece. Today, Austin Lee kindly brought me and Lini to the Carnegie Mellon Museum of the Art. It's amazing to see all the contemporary art, classic art, product design, also the historical Asian like stuff. There's so many things you can learn, but you have to develop your sensitivity. Why you think this is beautiful? Why this is disturbing? Disrupting in a positive way to make think something more deeper. So once you keep developing those stuff, then you understand what's the value of all the things you study. How many people tweet? Oh, that's so many. How many people following me? Oh my gosh, you have to follow me. Oh, it's a waste of your life. It's free. Okay, you don't need to. You don't need to remember anything about the lecture, but all the important things summarized 140 characters in the Twitter. So you should. But joke aside, Twitter is an exercise to condense, abstract your idea in 140 characters. Also, there's an art piece called Haiku in Japan. How many people know Haiku? 31 characters. Condense, abstract is something really good exercise. If it's an essence, you have to distill, crystallize. With some image or artifact, like abacus, tangible. So I think it's a good exercise to communicate. Also, because today I gave a very important lecture because Randy Pash brought me here back. So when I have a different story, different concrete remarks, always I tweet night before. The morning, how many retweets, how many likes come, helps me, especially my friends, who likes this one. So this is really a social like a filtering. You can learn from the society. But I really encourage you to do the exercise, to write the poems, condense, abstract, what's your idea, what's your point in the limited numbers of character. Limitation is the beauty. Designer have to make constraints as the best friends. Does that make sense? Please follow me. But the most important thing, not the followers number. I want to hear back from you. And also you see that what we are doing in a Facebook. So I hope I want to hear from you because your feedback really, really matters. Yeah. Good. That's a good question. The life is a bit messy because you have to remember so many things when you have to put garbage can of the non-burnable, blah, blah, blah. So many miscellaneous stuff. But always keep thinking about what kind of the future you really want to see happen for your kids or descendants, or also how your friends or students succeed. And that's something very important. I think one of the crazy comments, John Maida. How many people know John Maida? John Maida told me that the reason we're here to be an educator is to create assassins, to make you assassins so strong enough that you may kill me or John Maida. But I'm strong. I don't get killed so easily. That's a love, that's a tension, same as a friendship. So I think those things make me keep working hard because fundamentally, all my students are much better for anything, computer science, fabrication, writing paper, making a movie. I can't compete But still I have to really keep inspiring them. So that's tension, the mission, not to get killed, but to make them assassins. Really give a really great energy. I know it's half crazy, but me and John Maida are crazy. In a good way, good way. Yeah. Any other questions? I'm also stay here, so if you want to chat with me, you're welcome. Okay, come on, scream.
Hi, thank you for your presentation.
Thank you for coming. That's very interesting questions, and I don't know the answer. Let's take a music bottle as an example. Why I create music bottles? Because I was so sad. I lost my mom. So I want to make a dream, a promise I made but couldn't fulfill to come true in a new form of tribute. To do so, I have to use some technology, sensing technology. So it's a magnetic field, and the LC circuit, and the ferrite in a stopper. These are engineering stuff, electronics engineering. But when we made this one of my good friend, Toshio Iwai, the media artist, said, now you are invading my territory, which I didn't think, but I'm very flattered because he acknowledged this art. Also, when we went back to Arsenica this year, so many people missed music bottles we exhibited 15 years ago. This never get any award in the art award, but they remember, they loved it, the simplicity, stimulate imagination. You can put any imaginable content in any bottle. So like a little eye brush, people can't stop imagining. So now it became an art piece because those people saw some artistic stuff. So it's not how many percent your design, how many percent the technology, question I can't answer. But why you design, why you build it, why you made it is something important. Then if you execute, of course, I'm giving a lecture here, so I have to speak English. This might be technology. But the most important, there must be the message worth communicating. Also, you're spending your precious 1 hour. There must be meaning over there. That is beyond design, art, technology, but more like a meaning. So I don't know the answer, but maybe the rest of the world may say, oh, this is a design-ish, art-ish. But fundamentally, I want to continue that something I feel most important and inspiring. Also, it's the best reward if people I really admire get inspired, giving a positive feedback. That's really great. Like an audio part stimulate the musician in Barcelona, become a react table. Then many famous musicians use it. Also, InTouch, it's old device, three-roller device, inspires many media artists. They started the tactile force feedback art piece over distance. So I think seeing this influence, that's a reward. But I don't consider that how many percentage is what, because that's like something come later. It's an interesting question, because if we want to communicate some idea, of course, you have to use all the tools, like a keynote, graphic software, or typing stuff. But the most important is what do you want to accomplish, what do you want to communicate, whom you want to influence. To do so, what media you should use. I use Facebook, but also Twitter, because I want many people to come. Also, I want archive. After I'm gone, still Facebook photo album may stay there so people can see the old Arsenica. It's not making promote myself, but I want some people find our piece in 100 years, then get inspired. To do so, I have to archive it. So goal is not how to learn mathematics, mechanical engineering, computer science, but what I really want to do. To do so, what tools, what method, what discipline I have to learn, master. But then how to go to meta, to translate. So most important is the goal, mission, passion, rather than the means. Does this make sense? Okay. That's a very good question. And like you saw the shape display in form, but before 10 years before starting in form, also I have a dream to make a shape display, pin display. And we failed technically. Concept was there, but the technology was not mature. Now Arduino hardware became so easy to build. Also software processing, then Arduino, the hardware, also digital fabrication, that's dramatic. The floor becomes so low, and the ceiling became so high. But at long ago, computer was so slow. Also like a soundscape, I have to use a laser range finder, it's 40K cost, but now one Kinect allow you so many things. So we had a vision, but many couldn't really implement or fail to implement, so we can test it. Partially technical failure, might be also conceptual, it might be immature and weak, but unless you build it and experience, demo it, you can't really learn the limitation and the new potential. Intermaterial interaction, physical telepresence is something I never expected. Also the girl sang a song to the IO brush, it's just simply surprise. It's a pleasure. So I think building is very important because we are not a genius. We can't dream, imagine everything, but only when you build, test it, then see how audience react. So I think for me, bringing back 1,000 project to Ars Technica is something so important, not only each pieces, but also trajectory, development, evolution, and being alchemist of 21st century is something really fascinating. So you can really create new materials to materialize your idea. I have more failure. I can tell more later, but not in public. Yeah. Any other questions?
Here's one.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm highly interested in the integration of technology and design and art. And then for persons who do this kind of project, I think like I should have a strong understanding of various fields. But I wonder like which one
okay, I encourage you not to think art, design, technology, science is a solid stuff, which has a clear boundary. It's more like a mindset. Even architecture of some technology, like inform, we feel the beauty. Also programming language, small talk 80, APL, we feel the beauty. Aesthetics, it's art. So art, design, science, also science has a beauty. Simple mathematical equation explains so many things, the beauty. So there's no boundary. It's all the arbitrary boundary, institutional boundary, putting a label, I'm an artist, designer in the business card. We should have to stop it. What you want to do it, to do so you have to do design stuff, but always boundary between design and art is fuzzy. But it's okay, we are not really this, classifying the species. Like if you're Darwin, go to the Galapagos Island, you have to sample, you have to classify to come up with a hypothesis of the evolution. But another important is multimodal interface. Long ago, computer cannot handle many media, text, video, audio, all different files. Then my friend Bill Buxton teased like 20 years ago, if you want to see a computer, it's multimedia computer, count how many cables come from the back of the computer. All the data is separated. It's very immature stage because we are multimodals. I have no consciousness. I'm using a visual pixel or audio or body or stuff. All together, it's holistic. So this classifying, then putting each like a compartment doesn't make sense because we are very holistic, fundamentally multimodal. So I said multimedia is still each media is recognizable, countable, means immature stage of media evolution. That's the reason it should be seamless, fundamentally seamless, clear about people really don't think this is a Skype part or Google Doc part, but it's natural extension because metaphor. It's like you and seeing each other, then drawing together, seeing the common orientation. So I encourage you to forget the classification, like a library, literature, chemistry, applied mechanics, mathematics, geometry, forget. You should really focus on what you want to do it. Then you can see amazing talents. Some people say, some people you want to talk might be in the art department or design department, but it doesn't matter. It's just a temporal, like a place. Most important thing is there's no such boundary. Most important thing, what you want to materialize, what your dream is. Then what knowledge, skill you have to gain to make it happen. Okay?
Please join me in thanking Professor Ishii.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.